G'day and welcome back to another episode of Tomo's Tune-Ups. On this episode, I'm going to show you how to replace an ignition barrel on a classic Mini. Alright folks, so welcome back to the channel. So like I said, we are going to be replacing the ignition switch and barrel on Grace. Now, if you haven't already, make sure to check out the series in which I did for the Rolleston Classic 2023, in which the ignition switch failed and I had to use 3 gum nuts, a leaf and a piece of bark to be able to get this thing going. So we're going to start by removing the steering wheel, the column, pull everything out and then replace it. So let's jump into it. All right, so first thing we need to do is remove the steering wheel. What we need to be doing with the Leyland Mini is this little centerpiece just comes off quite easily. I've just got it SigaFlex on there, so it comes off quite easily. Put that off to the side. Now, we need to grab Old Faithful and a 1 5/16 socket. We're just gonna stick it on there and we're just gonna rattle it off. Oh. All right, there we go. Once the nut has come off, place it to the side, stick the rattle gun down there as well. Now, this is where it becomes important to make sure that when you remove it, you have the wheels facing straight ahead. So in our case, we know that the wheels is facing straight ahead. So we're just gonna wiggle it and just pull the steering wheel off. Make sure you put that always off to the side where it's not gonna get damaged. If it does have an airbag, make sure that when you remove the airbag, you face it upwards. That way, if it's gonna explode, it's gonna explode upwards rather than having it up the other way, in which is gonna cause it to detonate, fly to the roof, and then destroy something. So always place an airbag facing upwards. All right, so now, next thing we need to do is remove the shroud. We don't need to remove it just yet, but we're just going to because it is an easier step to do. Essentially, we're just gonna grab, if I can see a screwdriver around here, we're gonna grab a Phillips head. So there's a couple of screws up under here. We're gonna remove top and bottom sections. All right, so grab yourself a screwdriver. As I said, there are 2 screws just down up under here. You just gotta work those out. Now, I think every Mini is slightly different, so there's probably different style setups for this shroud if they run it. But you know, they're generally only hold on by a couple of screws, so it's not like they're the hardest thing in the world to do. Just stick those off to the side once you got them. Now, it will come off in 2 halves as well, so you'll have a top and a bottom half, and then just keep those off to the side. So there we go. Just put that down there for now. All right, so we've got the indicator assembly, and what we now need to do is remove, well, we don't need to remove it, but I'm just gonna remove the indicator assembly only because it is gonna make it a bit easier. Because the wiring that goes to the car, on the car end, I cut it off in my stupidity years ago, not realizing that they were pretty much a straightforward replacement fit. So all the wires are individual. So if I have to sit there and pull one off at a time, it's gonna take me forever to do it. So in this case, I'm just going to remove the indicator because it is, as I said, the easiest thing to do. You can generally just remove it from the main plug that the indicator goes to, and then you should be fine and won't have a drama. Now with the indicator, what you do need to do is just remove one screw as far as you can, well, pretty much essentially all the way out. It'll then twist and come off, pull it off to the side. All right, and that's it. Now, I've actually got mine cable tied on with the wiring harness down here, so we can undo that a bit later on. At the bottom of the steering column, so where the column meets the rack, there is a bolt and a nut. So in my case, mine's a 10 mil that I put in there. So I just need a 10 mil spanner and a socket with a ratchet, undo both of those. And then up under the bottom of the steering column, there are 2 half inch bolts you do need to undo. So make sure you undo those next. All right, so the next part is to remove this 10 mil that I've got just here. I do actually have a torque bit bolt for some reason, not sure how that came to be, but that's the sort of bolt that I decided to use in the bottom here. I think I lost the original one that went through, but you can just use probably like a 1/4 inch bolt to go all the way through, and just has to have a nut on either side of it as well. Once you sit here for painstakingly hours on end, you can then remove the bolt. All right, I'm just gonna speed up the process a little bit. Just grab a electric ratchet. There we go, take the nut out, and then the bolt will come out as well. Terrific. Now for the two up under the top. All right, so same thing again, grabbing an extension with a 1/2-inch socket and my electric ratchet. Rattle those out, one on either side. Sometimes they do come loose and you do need to put a nut on the other side, but I think these are pretty good from memory. I haven't had this out in quite some time as well. You can also get lowering brackets as well that go in here that allow you to lower the steering column if you need it down a little bit further or raise it up, I believe. All right, so next thing we need to do is just grab the column, give it a bit of a wiggle, and then it should just come straight off. All right, so the inner and outer columns are separate on these. It does make it a lot easier to be able to get them out. So generally what I do, we're just gonna remove that cable tie. I'm just gonna rotate that around and then just pull the column all the way up. That should be free enough where we can remove the entire thing. Now it does have some felt bushes down through here. So it might take a little bit to be able to get it out. We might actually replace those while we're here. And then that is the outer column lock assembly on a classic Mini. So going back to what I was saying, there are some little pieces of felt that go down in here. There's one that goes down the bottom and there's one that goes at the top as well. So for what it's worth, I'm probably gonna replace those while we're here, just because it is a cheap and easy thing to add in and prevents the column moving up and down as well. All right, so now comes the fun part of working out how the old ignition barrel comes off. So as you can see, that is the new one there. It does work pretty straightforward. It does have two shear bolts. So these here, the shear bolt is designed that after a certain amount of torque, they shear off and therefore you can't get them out without drilling it. On the other side, there are two Phillips head screws on there. So we just undo both of those along with the two Phillips heads. That'll come off. We position it, make sure that the center lock assembly goes directly in the middle. Once it's in there, put them on, tighten these up, snap them off, done, away you go. Now this is an anti-theft deterrent device. They are generally found on things like control units or ignition barrels, anything to prevent someone from stealing the car quite easily. So with the old one, we'll put that aside. Sorry, that's the new one. With the old one, it doesn't have any bolts here whatsoever. So I'd say they were originally all shear bolts. So you can just see the smaller sections. I'll just try and hold it up a little bit closer. You can see where it had been previously had the head on there as well. So what we're going to do, we're just going to drill those out. Once that's drilled out, the two halves will then just come apart and we should, fingers crossed, being the operative word, be able to remove the old ignition lock. So just quickly, I'll show you what actually broke on the Ralston. So there was supposed to be a wire just here, and this wire goes directly from here to here, which then goes to the ignition coil. So that's the reason why it's didn't decide to keep working, because it snapped off directly from here and I couldn't just wire it directly to the back, so we had to make our own circuit to make it work. And since then the car's been quite difficult to properly start, so I'm assuming that the circuit that I had it rigged up to is causing it to delay the starting motion. So like I said, with the shear bolts, they are a theft deterrent. So really, unless you really want to get the car, you're going to be out there, you're going to be drilling it, you're going to be grinding it to try and get this sort of stuff off. And by then, generally someone's been alerted and you're caught. So it is a really good thing to have. Once again, I'm just going to grab my pin punch, just centralize it, push down, and that way it'll just mark the middle of the bolt and we can use that to drill it properly. All right, so Tomo's tech tip is whenever you're doing anything like this or whenever you're using a drill, always make sure it is a nice sharp drill bit that will ensure that you can get it out properly. So we're just starting off with a small size and we're just going to drill it through just nice and easy. You also want to be going nice and so see how that's grabbing the piece of wire and it's pulling it up in like a little bit of spaghetti. That's exactly what we want to see. You don't want to be going too fast, otherwise you'll find it'll just blunten the drill bit very quickly. You can also opt to use some cutting oil when using a drill, but in our case, we can just go nice and slow. These drill bits are brand new, so they are super sharp, so we shouldn't have too much drama getting these out. Right, so with this, you want to drill as far as you possibly can, and then we're just going to grab a larger drill bit and then just drill all the way through until we shear the head of the bolt off, and then that'll separate it enough where we can release the old steering column lock from the assembly. Now, the steering column lock is part of the steering, part of the ignition barrel, so they work in conjunction with each other, and as part of Australian design rule, a car needs to be able to lock when you remove the key from the ignition. Failure to do so is going to be a rego failure, meaning that there. So that's your steering column lock. So when you pull the key out, that's what prevents someone stealing the car and prevents using the old crook lock. For those of you who are watching, know what a crook lock is. If not, please Google it. All right, next step, grab your vacuum, clean up all the debris. That way we're not going to make too much of a mess. I do have my little bin just underneath the vise over here, so it'll definitely catch a lot of stuff. Essentially, the next thing we're going to do is grab a larger drill bit. So I'm just going to grab a 10mm drill bit. That way we can drill it directly down through here. So you pretty much want it to be the same size as this. You want to drill it through till it gets to about the halfway mark, so to where the first sort of notch is. I'll just grab the other one and show you. So you want to be able to drill it all the way down to about here. The further you can drill, the better. You probably don't need to actually go that far. You probably only need to go about halfway, but you pretty much want to drill until you can remove the bolt entirely from there. So grab your drill. Once again, just same principle. It's going nice and easy. Just applying a medium force and just letting the drill do the work. And you'll actually know once you've cut far enough through, because you'll then see the smaller part of the thread compared to the head of the bolt. All right, so I've just drilled through there. Yep. So I'll just grab one of the cameras and I'll show you guys. So essentially, it's like drilling out a rivet. So I've drilled off the top of the head, and I don't know if you can really see there, but I'll just take a photo and show you guys off to the side. Essentially, we drilled the head of it off, and now we just got to go through and drill out the other three as well. So like I was saying, the idea of the shear bolt is that once it's tightened up, it'll actually shear the head of the bolt off, so it prevents you undoing it. So unless you are willing to sit there for, you know, 20, 30 minutes, if not longer, to be able to steal a car, to be able to get in and change the ECU or the ignition barrel or whatever it may be, I really doubt that anyone's going to want to spend the time doing this, hence the reason why they've done it. All right, so you know when it's free, when you can wiggle it, and you can separate the two halves. There we go. So I just gave that a bit of a push, and that just separated there. So I'll just empty that in the bin. So you can see just here that I've drilled them all out, and that the original bolts are still remaining in there as well. So that'll come straight off, put that off to the side, and grab the old lock, throw it in the bin. See you later. I'm gonna grab the vacuum. We're gonna clean up all this first. Now, my wife's probably gonna kill me because this is the inside vacuum and not the usual shop vac that I use. So, YOLO. So we are halfway there. So we grab our new lock assembly and then we can start fitting it. All right, so what I'm gonna do is just grab a little bit of emery cloth. I'm just gonna give that a little bit of a twist, a bit of a clean. Doesn't need to be perfect. I'm not overly fussed about it. We're not looking for a show quality finish. This thing never goes on display, and when it does, it's just for me to show off my pride and joy that I've done. All right, so that's where the steering column lock goes. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna fit it just in here. Just be very, very careful when fitting this inside a vise. The last thing I'm gonna be doing is tightening it up too much and then crushing it. So hopefully I can pull these bolts out of here, and then we can fit the column lock. All right, so all I've done is just remove the shear bolts out of here, and then we're just gonna fit it in there. So just gotta make sure you obviously fit it the right way. The key is gonna be facing the front. So the old one had a little locator here where it enabled it to go in one way. This one doesn't, it just got the tab for the key lock. So that'll just sit directly in there like that. Gonna grab the back half of it. I'll flip it over so you guys can see. Should also note that when you buy a new steering column lock, it does come with two new keys, so you don't need to be worried about there being any issues about not having the right key to it. So essentially, we're just going to put the shear bolt in offset, so that way they're on different angles. That way if anyone does try and ever steal it, it's not going to be very easy for them to do. That'll just find its sort of natural home of where it needs to sit. Just trying to make sure that both sides are square in terms of the gap on either side of there. So what we're going to do first is we're just going to tighten up the Phillips head screws. Once we tighten those, we'll then go and tighten up the shear bolts. I'm going to show you guys what it looks like when they shear off, literally. Shear bolts are also a one-time use item. Now let's just grab a socket. I'll just work out what size this is. It's going to be pretty small. I reckon it's probably going to be about a 5mm. No, smaller than that. So the bolt's winner is 7/32, however you say that. So we'll grab that, we'll grab a ratchet, and we'll show you how to do it. All right, so I've got my little 1/4-inch breaker bar. So essentially everything is in there, it's all lined up, we're all good to go. What you're gonna be doing is just twisting this until it comes off. So like I said, it will just get to a point in which it will just shear directly off. Put that straight in the bin, do the same with the other one. So it'll tighten up and then bang, snap, bang, and that's it. That's how you replace your column, or the column lock, should I say. So now we can just go reinstall it. Before we reinstall it, let's order some new bushes to go in the top and the bottom of the steering column. All right, so I'm actually gonna reuse the original felt that I had in there, that came out of the car from the last time that I pulled this apart. The last time I had this apart was, I think, 2017. So I did have this one wedged in there originally, and I think I damaged it at some stage because it's all starting to come apart. I remember the column started rubbing down the bottom, so I just yanked that out, or just jammed it back up in there, and I had a bit of play in the steering wheel. So what this felt does is it prevents the steering column moving down at the joint between the column and the rack, so it'll move up and down. So when you grab the steering wheel, it does have some sort of vertical play in it, so this just helps to eliminate that. Now some reason I had two, like I said, I probably just jammed this one up in there, so that's going straight in the bin. And this is going to be the one that we use. So this is available from Minisport, and we'll do this an episode. This is a a bit of felt that just wraps up on itself like this and goes down the bottom of the steering column. So as you can see here, it just goes directly down in there. So that just goes over the bottom and just helps to prevent any sort of lateral movement whatsoever. And at the top there is another bush. I'll just put a photo to the side of me here, what it looks like, but there's another one as well, and that's also going to stop any sort of movement. So make sure as well, when you have these apart, that you do put a new plastic bush in there and a new piece of felt. I think they're like 15 bucks each or something. I'll probably just put the price down below, but it's a really easy thing to do while you're there. You might as well. It is a plastic bush, so over time it is going to wear. If you haven't changed it in the last 30, 40, 50 years of the car being on the road, you might as well do it. So let's just reassemble this and make sure everything works. But before we do, because the new ignition switch has different wiring, it does come with a set of instructions. These little ones here, I'll put another photo down below. Essentially, it just tells you which wire goes to where. So we're just going to work out those individually and then go through and rewire the switch. All right, so I've already got the felt fitted inside there. Let's just hope that when we go to put the column back in, it's not going to push it all the way out like it sometimes does. I think you could probably even fit it to the bottom of the column, but we'll soon find out what we need to do. So that will actually, no, that's not going to work. So we need to take that out. Oop, there we go. So I'm just going to slide that on down there. And then we're just going to grab the piece of felt. I'm just going to put it down the bottom here. See if we can maybe just slide it over the top of it, which should enable the piece of felt to go through there as well. Just make sure you don't smash yourself in the face when you're trying to put the column on. All right. So once you're happy with where it sits, grab the two bolts and stick them in up underneath the column. Secure the column and then put the one in down the bottom. Now, as you saw, I did take the bolt out from down below, but I didn't actually need to because the inner part of the column actually stayed behind. So it's a bit irrelevant, but sometimes you'll find when you take it out, you just take the whole assembly out, which is probably gonna be easier rather than pulling it apart in two different sections. All right, tighten up your two bolts. Once you're happy with those, make sure that there's no play in it. Oh, that's all good. That's normal, that's all good. Next thing we need to do is work on the wiring for the new ignition switch. Get that all wired in, make sure everything works, and then we're all done. All right, for the next part, you're gonna need yourself a test light. So first of all, not only do you need a test light, but you need to find a good earth. So we're just gonna go off one of the bolts, either underneath the steering column, or a really good idea is to go off the striker. Now, it is advised as well to make sure that you always test your test light before you use it. Failure to do so will cause you to go down this garden path of it's not working, there's no power, tracing it all the way back, finding out that the globe inside here is busted, and hey, Bob's your uncle. You look like an absolute goose. So we're just gonna find a power source. So let's just switch on the headlights, for instance. And then we're just gonna test one of these wires. Yep, red means dead, so we're all good there. Excellent, that is a power wire, so that works, excellent. So I'm just gonna put that to the side, switch the headlights off. Now, first bit that we need to look at is the battery positive. So if you have a look at the little icon listed below, we're going to be looking for the red wire, which is the battery positive. So we're going to go to the ignition switch, so just down under here, and we're just going to be testing this and finding out where the power wire is. So we're just testing each one of these circuits. So that's definitely not it, that's not it, nor is this. Oh yep, sorry, the brown one is the power wire. So you can see there, it's got a pretty average sort of circuit there. Once I kind of wiggle it, it then starts working. So that tells me that that is 12 volts. So that will come directly from the fuse. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna cut that wire, and then we're going to connect this brown wire to the red one. So one of the best tools that I invested in is one of these. They are a wire cutter and stripper tool. So essentially down below here is the wire cutter, and the wire stripper is just up in here. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna shorten this just a little bit, cut that. We're gonna double check to make sure that this is actually power, which it is. You can see there, it's 12.7 volts, fabulous. We are just now going to strip the wire back here and make sure that we strip enough. Now, this is probably gonna be enough here, but what we're gonna do is we're gonna strip it back a little bit further. That way, when we solder it, we're gonna have a better contact to be able to solder it properly. So, I'm just gonna twist these. Apparently, you shouldn't twist the wires. Please let me know in the comment section below if you do twist your wires or not. So, we need to now grab the red wire. We need to strip that back. So before we go any further, what we're gonna be doing is just grabbing a little bit of heat shrink. So we don't need a great deal. I'm just gonna cut off, probably that much will probably do. We're gonna slide it onto the red wire here, so it slides all the way down. That way, after we connect it, we can then apply a bit of heat shrink. Heat shrink just helps to keep any water and ingresses out of the connection, but also just keep it safe as well. So it's not gonna short out against anything. So once they're connected, we're then gonna solder it. All right, so for this instance, I'm gonna be using the Ryobi soldering iron. This is probably the best soldering iron that I use. I have had gasless in the past, or a gas one, should I say. And look, they're okay, but it really just depends on what it is you're trying to achieve, and what sort of level of professionalism and what sort of skill set as well you have when you're soldering. So essentially, we just wanna heat the wire and then just apply the solder to it. Make sure that it contacts everywhere and completely fills the two wires together. So just take your time doing this and make sure you just do not spill it on carpet. All right, once they're connected, we're then gonna grab our heat shrink and we are going to apply it over the joint. Actually, before we apply the heat shrink, we're just gonna leave it for now, because worst case scenario is that if we apply the heat shrink now and we seal it, and then we put everything back together and it doesn't work, well then we're gonna have to cut everything again and shorten it. So let's just leave it how it is, and if we need to, we can make the modifications now without having to shorten or lengthen any of the wires. All right, so now that we've soldered all the wires together, we can now connect the ignition switch, and fingers crossed, we can get some ignition happening. So let's make sure that the wires do not touch each other. The plug goes on the correct way, as it will only face one way as well. All right, moment of truth. Hey, how good's that? So that concludes the episode. Essentially putting all back together is exactly the same as pulling it apart. There's not really much to do, just got to put the shroud on, got to heat shrink all the wires, make sure they're all fine. Once they're heat shrunk, we then just need to pull it up and tuck it out of the way. That way it's not going to interfere with anything and it's not going to touch, it's not going to rub. Make sure you secure as much wiring as you possibly can using cable ties. Other than that, put the shroud on, make sure the steering wheel is straight. If it's not, just put the nut on to begin with. Drive it down the road, find out where it needs to be. Maybe pull over, get it straight ahead where it needs to be. So whether it be left hand down, right hand down, upside down, whatever it is. Pull the steering wheel off, reposition it, and then just do it a couple of times. Worst case scenario, go get yourself a wheel on it. But that's essentially how you install an ignition barrel to a classic Mini.